Hello, welcome back to your free training for Windows 7. In Windows 7, there are two different ways you can restrict software from being run. The first method is software restriction policies. This is a group policy-based system that dates back to Windows XP and thus will work on any operating system since then. The second method is App Locker. App Locker is new to Windows 7 and has more features than software restriction policy. Unfortunately, App Locker is only supported on Windows 7 Enterprise and Ultimate Editions. The big difference with App Locker is that it can be applied to users and groups. Software restriction policy can only be applied at the computer level. App Locker has wizards to help with the process so that it is easier to use, while with software restriction policies, you need to set it manually. App Locker does have a few extra features and will be covered in the next video. In this video, I will concentrate on software restriction policies. App Locker is the topic of our next video. Software restrictions are group policy based. They are divided into global settings and rules. First, I will look at the global settings for software restrictions on my Windows 7 computer before I look at configuring rules. To configure the global settings for software restriction, first, open Local Group Policy Editor from the Start menu. From here, you want to go into Computer Configuration, Windows Settings, and Software Restriction Policies. At present, there are no software restriction policies defined. To create one, simply right-click on Software Restriction Policies and select New Software Restriction Policies. There are three global settings which apply to all software restrictions that you create. The first is enforcement. This setting determines to whom or to what the rules you create will apply. The default option sets software enforcement to all software except library files. Library files contain software functions that are called up by other software. End users generally do not access software via libraries, but rather by program executables, so I would leave this on the default. The next option decides who the software restrictions will affect. In an enterprise network where the average user does not have administrator rights, generally only the support people do, I would select the option All Users Except Local Administrators. This option means a general user will be affected by the software restrictions. However, if a support person were to log on to the computer to troubleshoot a problem, they would not be affected by the software restrictions. Software restrictions may make it harder for the software help desk person to troubleshoot the system. The last option allows you to enforce or ignore certificates rules. Certificates offer greater security, however, they also do create more load on your system. Also, you need to have a certificate infrastructure that is always available, otherwise your end users may find that they cannot run any software. The next global setting that you can apply to all rules is designated file types. This determines to which file types the software restrictions will apply. At the bottom, you will notice that you can add additional types if you need to. The last global setting is Trusted Publishers. This setting allows you to define who can make changes to the Trusted Publishers list on the computer. This basically means who can change the list of trusted certificates on this computer. At the bottom, you have a tick box. Verify that the publisher certificate has not been revoked. Once a certificate is issued by a certificate authority, that certificate may be revoked later or canceled, if you will. Like a concert ticket, once issued, it is not a simple matter to reclaim the ticket. It is much easier to issue a certificate than it is to revoke a certificate. To get around this problem, a certificate authority that issues the certificate also has a list of revoked certificates. To check if a certificate is valid, the computer simply needs to ask the certificate authority. This, of course, does have a performance penalty. The certificate authority will be able to tell the computer if the publisher's certificate is valid and has not been revoked. The last option allows you to check if the timestamp on the certificate is valid. Generally, checking the publisher's certificate is enough, but if you want extra security and don't mind the performance penalty, you can select this option. Now that you know what global settings are available, let's have a look at what rules can be applied with software restrictions. When using software restriction policy, there are 5 different rules that can be applied. These rules have an order of preference, so rules with higher preference will override low preference rules. The first type of rule is a hash rule. This creates a fingerprint of the program. This is basically a digital signature of the file by putting the file through an algorithm to obtain a number or hash. The advantage of this is that if the file is renamed or moved, the hash value will always be the same, and thus the file will be recognized. The disadvantage of a hash rule is that it only requires 1 bit of the file to change for the hash value to change. What this means is that if you have a different version of a program, you will need to create a new hash rule for every different program. For example, Minesweeper has been in every edition of Windows since it came out. However, if you wanted to block Minesweeper using a hash rule, you would need to create a hash rule for every single executable of Minesweeper to ensure that it gets blocked. Certificate rules use executables signed by the publisher using their certificate. This means that if all the applications from that vendor are signed by the one vendor certificate, you can create 1 rule for all software from that vendor. In order to use certificate rules, the executables must be signed. Most software nowadays are signed. If you look around your operating system, you will still find some executables from Microsoft that have not been signed. The major applications from Microsoft should all be signed. The disadvantage with certificate rules is that when an application is run, the certificate must be checked against the executable to make sure it is valid. This creates a performance penalty. Also, you cannot limit which applications you can and cannot run from a single vendor. For example, if you run Microsoft Office and want to allow all applications except MS Access, you cannot do this with a certificate rule. With certificate rules, it is all or nothing. Next is the path rule, which is the easiest to implement. In the path rule, you can specify a path, file name, or registry item. This means you may have a clash of rules. For example, you could block all programs in the document folder, but then create a path rule for an executable that you want to run also stored in the documents folder. When this occurs, the more specific rule will win. For example, if you allow access to a specific executable, this will always beat a rule based on a directory. The same goes in reverse. If you allow access to a directory but deny access to a file, the user will be denied access to the file because a specific rule has been created for that file, but will be allowed access to the directory. The disadvantage of this rule is that you can always move the executable to a location where the user has access to run. The next rule is zone rule. Zone rules only work in MSI packages that you download from the internet and only work with Internet Explorer. If you use an alternate browser such as Firefox, zone rules have no effect. Zone rules, as the name implies, work off the zone that MSI packages are downloaded from. For example, you could deny all MSI packages from being downloaded from the internet, but allow them to be downloaded from the local intranet. The last rule is the default rule. This rule is run when no other rule matches. It acts as a catch-all. If you set this rule to disallowed, no application will be allowed to run unless it is specified by another rule. If you are going to use the disallow setting, make sure you do a lot of testing first. Otherwise, you may upset a lot of users when they find they can no longer run software they need to do their job. The next setting of the default rule is basic user rule. When set, users will be able to run any software that does not require administrative rights. Lastly, you can set the default rule to unrestricted. This rule allows the user to execute any application that does not have a rule stopping it from running. Now that you understand the rules and the order in which they are applied, I will go back to my Windows 7 computer and configure them. The first thing that I will do is configure the default rule. This is found under Security Levels. Here are the three settings you can set the default rule to. The first is Disallow. This will stop any software from running that does not have an allow rule created for it. The next setting, Basic User, will only allow software to run that does not require administrator rights. And lastly, Unrestricted will allow all software to run. To set the default rule, select one of the settings and then press the button Set as Default. The default level is unrestricted, so I will get a warning telling me that the level I am setting it to is more restrictive and thus may cause some software to stop running. I have now set up a catch-all stopping all software from running unless a rule has been set up to allow it to run. If I go to my desktop and attempt to run Minesweeper from the desktop, you will notice it will still run. Certain system files will still be able to run even with a default rule of unrestricted running. If this is not the case, your operating system would not run at all. The Minesweeper executable is located in the Windows folder, and that is why it has been allowed to run. I also have a copy of the Windows XP Minesweeper on the desktop. If I attempt to run that one, I receive a message saying that this program has been blocked by group policy. If I go back into group policy, in the Additional Rules section, you will notice that two rules have been created by default. These two rules have been created to allow system software to run without being blocked. If I now want to create a rule to allow Minesweeper to run from the desktop, I can right-click the Additional Rules area and select Next Path Rule. Now all I need to do is browse to the desktop. Notice that I can set the action to either Disallow, Basic User, or Unrestricted, as before. Once the rule has been set to unrestricted, if I go back to the desktop, I can now run the old version of Minesweeper without any problems. This rule will, of course, allow any software to run stored on the desktop. I could create a path rule with just the Minesweeper executable, but if the file were moved or another file copied over this file, the desired effect would not be achieved. If I go back into group policy and delete this rule and this time create a hash rule, I can select the Minesweeper executable. This will allow this and only this file to run, regardless of if it gets renamed. Unfortunately, it also does mean that I need to create a new hash rule for every version of the software that I want to run. Software restriction policies can be very powerful if you understand the right ones to use in which scenario. Not much has changed with group policy software restriction policies since Windows XP. In the next video, I will look at the new system called App Locker, which has a few extra features not included with software restriction policy. App Locker can be used in Windows 7 Enterprise and Ultimate Editions to control which applications your end users can access.